Pastor Gallagher and the session for granting me the privilege of being a part of this series on ethnicity. What's the third thing? I wrote this down. Hold on. Ethnicity, arrogance, and the call of Christ. This really does feel like a bit of a homecoming for us. Rebecca and I still, from time to time, remind each other of the verses Dr. Boyce wrote in our new members booklet. For Rebecca, it was Philippians 4:8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. And for me, it's Matthew 5:14. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. It seems particularly appropriate that you all have asked me to come back given my history. I was a National Director of Ethnic Student Ministries for 11 years. And so I've spoken any number of times on matters of race and ethnicity. And it's a question that comes up repeatedly when you're seeking to reach ethnic minority audiences with the gospel, often framed in one form or another of the question, isn't Christianity the white man's religion? So in light of all of that sort of experience talking about this, I wasn't really sure what I was going to offer you all this evening. But when I heard Pastor Liam's message this morning, I knew that the Holy Spirit had led me right. There's a lot of resonance between what he shared and what I hope to share with you this evening. I hope to approach this topic from a couple of different angles, one being historical, the other biblical, theological. So please, and it's a lot. So bear with me, hang with me, and pray with me. This evening I want us to look at the passage which was read in your hearing. It's not often considered when we wrestle with questions of race. I'd like to explore Acts chapter 15 for just a few minutes with the question, can you imagine? Or perhaps it would be better phrased, why can't we imagine? When we pick up the story in the 15th chapter of Acts, it's been roughly 15 years since the day of Pentecost. 15 years since Jesus was crucified, died, and buried, raised on the third day. 15 years since he had ascended into heaven with a promise to return. But when we think of that scene at the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit descended and the church was inaugurated, we normally focus on the fact that there were people there from all over the Hellenistic world. But I think sometimes we don't consider the fact that all those folks we're talking about were Jews. Christianity began as a very Jewish religion, so much so that it's referred to in Acts 28:22 as a sect of the Jews. And so here in Acts 15, 15 years after that occasion on the day of Pentecost, we need to be aware of the fact that the followers of Jesus had just begun in the last few years before this, getting serious about Jesus' command to take his message to all the peoples of the earth, as he instructed them to do in Acts 1:8 and as well as in Matthew 28. Now, during that intervening period, God had not been silent. He had been poking and prodding the church to do what Jesus had said to do. And after about 8 years, God gave Peter and a Gentile named Cornelius corresponding visions that brought them together so that Cornelius, a God-fearing Gentile, might hear and respond to the gospel. Now, as several more years have passed and the gospel began to spread among the Gentiles, a controversy arose. Some of those early Jewish Christians were of the opinion that these new believers in Jesus had to be circumcised and follow the law of Moses. The text says in verse 5, that the formal challenge to this idea of a non-circumcised salvation came from the Pharisees. Why? Was it because the Pharisees were just such bad people? I don't think so. I don't think that does justice to the biblical witness about the Pharisees. You see, the party, the Pharisees, or the set apart ones, had been the reformers of the Jewish faith. Their original motivation was to preserve or restore the religious faithfulness of the Jews in light of the judgment their nation had experienced in the form of the Babylonian conquest and captivity. Like many movements of reform, they had institutionalized their views and built an elaborate system around them. That is why they came up with the complex structure of rules, standards, and requirements for their people to follow. These extra-biblical codes and the arrogance, pride, and hypocrisy they produced were what Jesus repeatedly and resoundingly condemned. Yet the text tells us that many of the Pharisees responded to Jesus. We see this as early as the story of Nicodemus, and the Apostle Paul himself identifies as having been a Pharisee. So when we think about their history, their background, what their emphasis was, it makes sense that among the many Pharisees who came to believe in Jesus, there was a desire to preserve the Jewish purity of worship among those who acknowledged Jesus as Messiah. In their minds, Gentiles were welcome in light of Peter's revelation from God in Acts chapter 10, but those who came to faith in the Messiah needed to convert to Judaism as an expression of that faith, because Christianity was, after all, a Jewish faith, was it not? The answer of the council in verse 19 was a resounding no. We should not make it difficult for those of the Gentiles who are turning to God. It's fascinating to me that the words that are translated, those of the Gentiles here, is ton ethnon. The root here is ethnos, the Greek word from which we get the word ethnic, and it speaks of peoples or nations. You could easily translate this, those of the nations or those of the peoples who turn to God. What the council decided was that we should not add our religious and cultural assumptions, values, requirements to the purity of the gospel. They went on to say in verses 20 to 21 that if the Gentile followers of Jesus were committed to abstaining from three things, that was enough. One, meat sacrificed to idols. In other words, they were committed to spiritual purity. There could be no syncretism in this newfound faith because God is a jealous God. There would be no patience with idol worship. There is nothing in common between the worship of Jesus and the worship of idols. The second was to abstain from sexual immorality. Now, it's not difficult for me to see why this was important, but it seems that even this most fundamental aspect of Christian identity is under assault today. The sanctity of marriage does, in fact, predate the fall itself. So it is significant that we who name the name of Christ adhere to that which the Bible declares is the appropriate context for sexual expression. It's important that we hold this line. But then it says the third thing was blood and strangled meat. Now, you might think that this is a concession to an aspect of the Mosaic Law, but again, it predates Moses significantly. It goes back all the way to Genesis chapter 9, just after the flood. Why did God make this qualification or limitation? A couple of reasons are often inferred. One possibility is to preserve the health of his people. Many have surmised that the dietary laws were to provide a divinely delivered prescription for healthy eating, which stood in stark and particular contrast to the standards of hygiene in the ancient world. But I believe with most that it was to point to the significance of blood in God's religious economy. There was blood guilt on humankind due to our sin. And the blood of animals was used under the old covenant as a symbol of the blood debt to be paid by the Messiah to come. And at this point in the unfolding of God's salvation history, it makes sense to emphasize the blood sacrifice that Jesus had willingly made on behalf of humanity. So what the council was requiring was simple holiness. The problem is that sometimes, just like those first century Christians, we add other things to our definition of what we expect in the way of holiness, or to be more specific, what our kind of Christian entails. The list in Acts 15 is short. Our lists sometimes get long. There is a simplicity to the devotion of Christ that is outlined here, a simplicity of the requirements of what it meant to be a disciple of Christ, not circumcision, not keeping the Mosaic law. And I want to draw a connection here between the Jewish religion and Jewish culture. What the council decided was that these believers did not have to conform to Jewish religious culture to be faithful followers of Jesus. You see, the early Christians who were of the party of the Pharisees were not able or willing to imagine that God could or would save uncircumcised, non-law-keeping people. Well, you may say, what does this text have to do with the challenge of racism in the 21st century church? The question I place before you today is, can you imagine? I pose the question this way because, as I've just done, one way to describe the problem those Pharisaic Christians were having is that they lacked theological imagination. In his book, The Christian Imagination, Professor Willie James Jennings analyzes the Chronicles of Azuara, who documented the activity of the 15th century Portuguese Infante, Henry the Navigator, who instigated the transatlantic slave trade. Henry did so with an imagined mandate to civilize and Christianize the dark-skinned inhabitants of Africa. This imagined mandate, embedded in a will to earthly empire and the concomitant exploitation of other human beings, is both diagnostic and predictive. It's diagnostic because it reveals the origins of the racism embedded in the colonial imperial aspirations which were taking root in Europe, intertwined with a twisted sense of Christian mission. And at the same time, it predicts the deep, abiding notions of racial and religion-based privilege which are endemic in the world those 15th century explorers, conquerors, and missionaries brought into being, the world we now occupy. In another important study, J. Cameron Carter exposes the virulent racism embedded in the thought of 18th century Enlightenment philosopher Immanuel Kant. In his book, Race, A Theological Account, Carter delineates the racial taxonomy Kant espoused, in which white people occupy the highest pole and black people's the opposite, lowest end of that spectrum. These two examples serve as illustrations of the fact that racial distinctions were used to religiously justify and intellectually defend the subjugation and exploitation of other groups of people in the modern era. This has persisted or manifested itself in the thought, the notion, the imagination that white people are the best, most civilized, and most Christian, and that black people are the least civilized and only able to produce a caricature of Christianity. This view goes on to assume that those who share any of the characteristics of the black race and its various cultures are sullied, soiled, damaged, deficient, or in some way less than those who are white. Let me be clear. Theological imagination, the term, has become a bit of a catchphrase. And there are those who are co-opting it to suggest that we need to think and act beyond the boundaries of the revelation of God's will contained in the Bible. That is, in my view, a tactic of the evil one, to take an important truth and conflate it with lies and deceit, so that those who should take the truth seriously will become confused. The enemy's aim is to use that confusion to hinder what is true and right from taking hold. What I am saying is this: a healthy theological imagination is the ability to conceive and receive that which God has declared in His Word. Conversely, a lack of theological imagination is the inability to conceive or receive that which God has revealed to us in the Scriptures. And how should we as Christians approach these things? Well, first of all, we have to recognize that the roots of the rationalization of oppression and discrimination, the idea that there are those who are destined to rule and those who are destined to be ruled, the privileged and the proletariat, the superior and the inferior, was given philosophical expression as early as Aristotle. So this notion was in the air in the context in which the New Testament was recorded. Yet the Epistle of James makes it clear that to favor any one group over another is incompatible with Christian faith and practice. But as we trace the history of the church, really from the time of Constantine, when it became an accepted religion of the Roman Empire, I argue that we can observe a lack of healthy theological imagination, the kind of healthy theological imagination I am asking us to embrace today. In short, those early Christians in the third and fourth century had difficulty imagining a church thriving without imperial authority. But empires prosper on the notion of the superior and the inferior, the rulers and the ruled, the privileged and the deprived, those at the center and those at the margins. This contradiction, this conflict in values, led to great evils, progressively and persistently corrupting the church, over time causing it to rot to its core. Even during the Reformation, as needful and dramatic as it was, most reformers continued to rely on the state to support their particular understanding of what the church should be and do. And as Carter and Jennings have documented, this combination of church and state bore one of its more hideous children in the modern slave trade. That was then. But what does Christian racism look like today? Well, sometimes it's just raw, naked tribalism, preferring my people over your people, my church over your church. But for most of us, I think we are more like those early Jewish Christians. Some of us have difficulty imagining that God could work outside of our tradition or our culture. Now, we know and will affirm that the gospel transcends culture. Yet along the way, we've added many other things to our understanding of, our assumptions about, and therefore our proclamation of the gospel, cultural expectations and trappings, in some cases theological systems, which while seeking to make sense of the complex data in the Christian scriptures, can become a new kind of Phariseeism. The modern missionary movement has wrestled with this cultural imperialism and now generally works to overcome that intrinsic bias. And as a result, much of what God is doing to incarnate the gospel around the world defies these categorizations. Much of what God is doing to spread the message of Jesus Christ does not fit in our nice, neat guidelines. And as a result, the truth is there are Christians, followers of Christ around this country, yea, even in this city, that each of us may find difficult to embrace as our brothers and sisters in Christ. Now, that problem is not simply a matter of race, but race is one of the complex factors that fuel our ongoing discomfort. Might we be guilty of a different, subtle form of Pharisaic Christianity? We declare that we no longer conflate the church and state in this country. Or do we? Could we, in our concern for pure ministry or pure theology or even pure worship, be subtly adding things to the simplicity of the gospel? Are we so intent on the purity of the ministry that we cannot conceive of good, effective, eternally significant ministry occurring outside of our particular cultural expression of Christianity? Jesus told his disciples to make yet more disciples from every people group on the planet, according to Matthew 28:19. But he said, teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. He didn't say, not what you do with my teachings, not what your theological heroes have interpreted me to have said. The Apostle Paul taught us that in order to make disciples, we must be willing to become all things to all people, according to 1 Corinthians 9. This means that we need to allow for expressions of ministry that don't fit into our limited ability to conceive, our truncated theological imaginations. Because doesn't Ephesians 3:20 say, now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. So we ought not be surprised when God's resurrection power shows up in something outside of our ministry or cultural paradigms, or that functions in a manner that doesn't match up with all our expectations. I fear that our natural tendency is to want our disciples to be just like us. We most readily recognize our brothers and sisters in Christ who are just like us. Sometimes even those who are ministering cross-culturally maintain a posture of superiority, ascendancy, or control, because that's when we are most comfortable. So I stop by this evening to challenge you that if God is giving you the opportunity to minister to or have fellowship with a believer from another culture or another tradition, one's goal should not be that they end up just like you. Ask yourself the question, what does an ethnic minority person need to be like for me to receive them, recognize their leadership ability, see their true value in the kingdom of God, and learn from them? God's word declares that his church is a multilingual, multi-ethnic, and multicultural reality. We see that clearly displayed in Revelation 5:9 and 7:9 when it speaks of a multitude from every people and tribe and tongue and nation gathered around the throne of the Lamb. I think it's significant that even this, in this eschatological vision, there's a fourfold description of cultural and ethnic diversity. God's kingdom is not intent on obliterating those differences, but allowing the incarnation of the gospel in those unique cultures to be added to the voice of our global witness. Sometimes, even when we verbalize an eagerness for that day, when it presents itself here on earth, we do not always greet it with enthusiasm, because it makes us uncomfortable. We must be uncompromising about the gospel and our adherence to God's word, but allow for, celebrate, and look to learn from those whose readings of the scriptures emerge from different experiences and different cultures than our own. As the last couple of years have reminded us, there is a desire, even among Christians, to perpetuate one's own power or to use the levers of secular power to preserve or gain even more privilege for people who are just like us. This is not God's will. This is not God's way. Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world." May God deliver us from earthly pursuits of power. May God grant us grace to be honest about our fears and motivations. May God call many of us to be cross-cultural emissaries within the church. Or perhaps I should say, between the churches, in our own communities and in our nation, yea, even around the world. When he does, and when we obey, God will bring great glory and honor to himself. I believe we will experience the promise of John 17, 20 to 23, when Jesus prayed, "My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I've given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me." When we who believe in Jesus find ways to come together in biblical unity, not a culturally homogenous unity, not an imperially mandated unity, but in an organic, Christ-focused, culturally diverse, mutually respectful, broad-based oneness, God will be honored, and the world will know that the Father sent the Son. Can you imagine that future with me? Will you pray with me to that end? Oh God, we confess, Lord, that too often our vision is too myopic. We see what's in front of us. We relate to those who are like us. We care most about our own families, our own people. And while that's natural, Lord, allow us to recognize our brothers and sisters who are not like us, who speak different languages, who come from other cultures, who've had different experiences. Lord, in the religious traditions, the Christian traditions that they've produced, operate differently. Lord, show us how to embrace them, how to love them. And Lord, may we engage in conversations that allow us to learn from one another. Lord, perfect our collective witness that when the world looks at your church, they don't see scandals and problems. They don't see unrighteousness and a desire to lift up one people over another, but they would see those who have a mutuality that hurts when others hurt, that weeps when others weep, that invest in the problems that are affecting various communities. Oh Lord, grant us grace to excel still more in our practice of these things. Lord, preserve us from a subtle Pharisaism that cannot understand how you could work in people like that. Lord, may we see the boundaries that are in your word, and may we honor what your truth in fact is. Help us to be the kind of men and women who embrace all who name the name of Jesus Christ, who obey the boundaries that are here in your word. Lord, may we never involve ourselves in syncretism. May we maintain a standard of sexual morality. And Lord, may we be those who respect, honor, and recognize the incredible sacrifice Jesus made on the cross to pay for our sins. May all of us who have been washed by that blood, recognize one another, embrace one another, that the world might know that you have sent your Son. And we pray this in his strong and mighty name. Amen.